rate at which we are going, steps are not taken to curtail the seeming impunity with which journalists get to be attacked, a journalist is going to be killed in Sierra Leone.
One of them came and kicked me on my back and I fell down.
So in the course of our doing our job, we should get protection from the state security.
And they should not be the ones.
And they should not be the one attacking us. That is a complete violation and a complete contravention of their responsibility.
This is Sierra Leone in West Africa. I was born and raised here, later working as a freelance and then as a staff writer on For the People and the Chronicle newspapers. Now living in the UK, I went on holiday to my beloved Salome, as we call it. That trip was the inspiration for this film. The country's 11-year civil war has now ended, but it's still a dangerous place if you happen to be a journalist. This is Umaru Sita Touré, editor of Freetown's New People newspaper. He was nearly killed in a vicious knife attack in May of 2009 after his paper ran a story that was critical of the president, Ernest Bai Koroma. The paper blamed the head of state for the harassment and intimidation of two local journalists. His attackers missed his jugular by inches. Doctors said he was lucky to be alive. One of his three attackers, Alimami Kamara, happened to be a photographer in the office of the president at State House in the capital Freetown. The New People named the president's press secretary, Sheka Tarawali, as the man directing a campaign of intimidation against Sylvia Blyden, publisher of the Awareness Times newspaper. Tarawali's beef with the Awareness Times was that 2 days previously, on May 12th, the paper had published the so-called fake First Lady story. The article said a female friend of President Koroma's was masquerading as the First Lady. Claiming the paper had libeled his boss, Tarawali allegedly sent police to arrest Blyden and Abdulkarim Kabia, the paper's editor. When the two journalists were not found, a nationwide alert was issued for their arrest.
Amnesty has documented in its annual report just out this year that several journalists have been harassed and have been attacked, sadly, over the course of the year in Sierra Leone. We are particularly concerned about the level of repression on the media in that country at the moment.
Amnesty International say they are concerned about threats against Awareness Times staff.
That is particularly concerning, especially if we think about one editor of the Awareness Times, Sylvia Blyden, who was recently arrested and for quote-unquote ridiculing the president or criticising the government. Since then, she's received death threats and she's been forced into hiding. And that is a particular concern for us, and we would continue to urge the authorities in Sierra Leone to put an end to the media restrictions that take place in there.
Attempts by governments to muzzle the media are not new in Sierra Leone. A landmark moment came in 1977 during the All People's Congress, or APC, government of the late former president, Siaka Stevens. As he steered the country towards one-party rule, Stevens sent thugs to burn down the offices of the outspoken tablet newspaper, which was campaigning against the one-party state. Many of the tablet's reporters fled into exile. Ironically, one of those fearless reporters, Hindolo Tri, is now a minister in the present APC government. In more recent times, attacks on press freedom peaked in July of 2005 during the previous government of the SLPP, the Sierra Leone People's Party. That was when Harian Sané, editor of my former paper, For the People, was severely beaten up. Sadly, he died from his injuries. His assailants were the sons of one Fatmata Hassan, an SLPP politician who took exception to his paper's style of reporting. Yansane had become editor For the People after substantive editor Paul Kamara was jailed for 2 years. He had been convicted of seditious libel against Ahmed Tijan Kaba, who was president at the time. Successive governments have used the provisions of the 1965 Public Order Act to muzzle the media. The act makes libel a criminal offense, with stiff penalties attached. This was Kamara after his release from prison. At least 15 journalists have been killed in the line of duty in Sierra Leone, many of them at the hands of either soldiers or rebels during the civil war. This led the International Federation of Journalists to call Sierra Leone the most dangerous place on earth for reporters. It was against this backdrop of repression of the independent media that the government of Ernest Koroma came into office in November 2007. Many thought it was the dawn of a new era of tolerance for a free press. This optimism was based, among other things, on the fact that many reporters who had suffered under SLPP rule were some of the new government's allies. The new government actively courted these expectations. It made all the right noises, in all the right places. In January 2008, 2 months after his inauguration, President Koroma assured SLAJ, the Sierra Leone Association of Journalists, that his government would repeal the draconian provisions of the Public Order Act. He made a similar commitment the following month, while on a visit to Britain. That same February, Vice President Samuel Sam-Sumana directed the Law Reform Commission to, and I quote, expunge all laws dealing with freedom of expression, including the Public Order Act. These were indeed fine words by honorable men, but even as they were being said, Jonathan Lee, editor of the Independent Observer newspaper, was languishing in police cells. He had written about alleged corruption involving a government minister. Later that month, Sylvia Blyden was also arrested for alleged defamatory libel and a previously unknown crime, subjecting the head of state to ridicule. In the summer of 2008, 7 journalists were beaten up by police while on assignment at State House. The reporters had gone there to cover a crisis meeting between SLPP officials and President Koroma. This was after a mob of government supporters attacked the Freetown headquarters of the SLPP. They assaulted the party's workers and supporters and thrashed the premises. Equipment belonging to Unity Radio, the opposition radio station, was also damaged by the mob. The police assault on the journalists occurred here, just outside the State House gatehouse, where the reporters had gathered to seek entrance into the building. According to Alima Fofana, a reporter with the exclusive newspaper, when the reporters arrived, the police refused them access into State House. They asked the reporters to identify themselves, which they did. They then asked the reporters to wait by the gates, which they did. But moments later, Fofana said, the police changed their minds and suddenly turned on the journalists.
The policemen, Cisco, came and said, we don't want to see any journalists, all of you, go, 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 go. And he started slapping us. So we were about to leave. When we saw some of the police officers chasing us with sticks. So on the way, one of them came and kicked me on my back and I fell down. I get up again to run. They got hold of me, they started beating me. They even dragged me, took away all of my equipment.
The police, in a manner of speaking, gave the reporters a good hiding. Their telephones, cameras, and other equipment were either damaged or stolen. Although they later received compensation for the assault, it is instructive to note that none of the police were disciplined for this attack on the defenseless and unsuspecting reporters. Further, the compensation did not extend to replacing their damaged or stolen equipment. This was yet another physical assault on journalists going about their legitimate business. And they were attacked by, of all people, the police. Such attacks on media practitioners are by no means limited only to Freetown. A radio broadcaster, Jibril Gotto, was violently assaulted by APC supporters for allegedly sabotaging the government in his reports from Cambia in the northern region. In Pujehu, in the south of the country, a radio program had to be aborted after its equipment was destroyed and one of its reporters assaulted. And last but not least, Kenema in the eastern region was the scene of a brutal assault by police of Faya Amara, a regional correspondent for the Standard Times newspaper. I had many questions which needed answers. From the police, State House officials, and the Minister of Information. However, none of them agreed to an interview, whether on or off the record. It was then that I heard of a pending press conference at the Ministry of Information. My sources said the minister or his deputy would be there. I knew I would be. It was a date I wouldn't miss for the world. The press conference was taking place 3 months after the attack on Fofana and her colleagues. I was eventually able to put my question to Mohammed D. Koroma, the Deputy Minister of Information, who also happens to be a journalist.
You don't announce his name.
It's Julian Samboma.
Oh, Mr. Boma, sorry. Samboma, sorry.
Yeah.
My question to him was this. What is the state of press freedom in the country? And what did the brutal assault of journalists by police say about the state of press freedom? The minister did not give me a straight answer. But after many digressions and tangential observations, he filled in many blanks.
So if we are asking for our freedom, are we prepared to know where the limitation of our freedom reach? Are we sure we are different from the ordinary man on the streets? Because as journalists, yeah, people think they are extraordinary. No, we are not extraordinary from the ordinary man on the street. We are the same. The only distinction is the ID card we have as journalists. Now, you mentioned about humiliating journalists recently.
They were beaten up.
That is humiliation.
Yes, sir.
Okay, they are beaten up.
Koroma, who is now Deputy Minister of Health, then went on to justify police brutality against reporters by invoking the country's recent violent past. He likened the police to peacekeepers and the reporters to rebel fighters. He compared the injured reporters to collateral damage, the accidental casualties of what can only be described as the ruling party's undeclared war on the legitimate opposition.
Do we know how to report areas of incidents? Do you know how many journalists that have been killed in areas of conflict? When we report conflict situations, is it different or they are different from reporting press conferences or seminars? When there are confessions, you want to get the truth of them, please let us ready to have the blues. We are not expected, oh, because I'm a journalist, I should not be king. No! You enter the conflict. And when you enter a conflict, you want to get the truth of that conflict. And you must be ready to get the suffering of that conflict. That will make you a credible journalist if you come out with the truth and publish it in the morning. You are different from the man who sits in the house and looks at the TV only to publish a story.
Excuse me, sir. With all due respect, sir, Mr. Minister, they were assaulted by the supposed peacekeepers, because if we're using the analogy of conflict, there's conflict between two different groups of supporters, and the peacekeepers, if you like, were the ones who, doing the assaulting against the journalists.
Police officers.
The journalists. Yes, yes, sir.
During the dark days of the rebel war,
yeah,
it was difficult to distinguish between a rebel and an ordinary man. So it's a journalist. You don't have any flag on your head to say I'm a journalist. That is why I said reporting conflict is the most difficult situation for journalists.
Okay.
I tell you,
right,
you'll die, you'll be kicked, you'll be slapped.
What the minister failed to acknowledge was that the reporters were assaulted not at SLPP headquarters during the attack by government supporters, but at the gates of State House hours later. I was not able to put this to him as he had moved on to other matters. Newspaperman Philip Neville was at the time acting president of SLAJ. I put it to him that journalists were not extraordinary people and therefore, according to Deputy Minister Koroma, not exempt from routine beatings by policemen.
We have a job to do, and that job, we have to do that job. We do what we know, and we do what the people want us to do, despite the fact that we are not extraordinary people. Therefore, we are expecting that the state apparatus or the state security should be able to protect us, because they are charged with the responsibility of protecting life and property. So in the course of our doing our job, we should get protection from the state security.
And they should not be the ones.
And they should not be the one attacking us. That is a complete violation and a complete contravention of their responsibility.
As we have seen, none of the police involved in the State House incident were ever disciplined. If anything, the minister's inspired defense of their actions provides a justification for them. His extraordinary defense of police brutality presents to the outsider a rare insight into the mindset of the Ernest Koroma government. It depicts an essentially Orwellian worldview, one in which Sierra Leone is in a never-ending state of war. In this permanent state of emergency, arbitrary violence by the state is justified. The motivations of citizens cannot be trusted, and the coercive machinery of the state is close at hand to keep them in line. The activities of the legitimate opposition and the independent media are perceived as potent threats which must be eliminated. The Koroma government, it would seem, believes in the dictum that all is fair in love and war, more so in its other undeclared war against the free press. Earlier in this film, we met Shaka Tarawali, the president's press secretary. If Deputy Minister Koroma is the great rationalizer of government repression of the media, Tarawali is the enforcer. He is the president's answer to the Godfather's Luca Brasi.
Go ahead. What the hell is this?
That's a Sicilian message. That means Luca Brasi sleeps with the fishes.
Local journalists see the press secretary's hand in many, if not all, the instances where they have been assaulted, arrested, or otherwise harassed by the state. Unlike Luca Brasi, who famously went to sleep with the fishes, he would be the one telling seaside bedtime stories to the Godfather's critics in the media. Also a journalist, Tarawali still runs his Torchlight newspaper. He is on record as saying that, some years ago, when his paper was in financial difficulty, it was Ernest Koroma, the man who would be president, who came to the rescue. His loyalty to the president is legion. Here is Blyden.
The person who wasn't just an assailant, it was a group of people who attacked him. And actually slashed him around his neck just by his jugular vein. Mm. He had to be rushed to hospital. I mean, the man was practically pouring blood. He had to be rushed to hospital, and he got no less than 10 stitches around his jugular vein to save his life. It was a group of supporters of the ruling party, including a very senior employee of the State House.
When you say very senior employee of the State House, how senior?
Somebody who works in close proximity with the president, who works directly under the supervision, the purview of the presidential press secretariat.
Also incidentally, the attack on Fofana and her colleagues was perpetrated by police station at State House, which just happens to be the press secretary's office block. All of this, of course, does not establish a direct link between Mr. Tarawali and what some see as the attempted murder of a journalist. The very busy press secretary also finds time to pen articles for his paper. In them, perceived enemies of the government are singled out for personal attack. For example, he has used the pages of the Torchlight to smear Blyden as conducting affairs with members of the opposition and the government in return for so-called favors. Like him, Deputy Minister Mohamedi Koroma has also maintained a hands-on role at his African Champion newspaper. The rag is used to laud the government and to besmirch the reputations of those he no doubt sees as enemy combatants.
Ironically, both Tarawali and Koroma have sought political refuge in the UK, claiming persecution by the then SLPP government of Ahmed Tijani Kabah.
This is the third member of the triumvirate, Ibi Kagbo, the veteran journalist who is Minister of Information and Broadcasting. Publisher of the New Citizen newspaper, he prefers to work in the shadows. He revealed his hand recently when he threatened to revoke the licenses of two newspapers. They had claimed that he instructed police to ban a demonstration against anti-press laws. On two occasions now, he has banned the SLPP's Unity Radio from operating. But he was forced to also close down the APC party's radio after accusations of political bias. Radio broadcaster Calvin Connell laments the fact that pressmen were now directing attacks against press freedom.
We have come a long way, and Sierra Leoneans has become used to that way of life, where they can freely express themselves, you know, where people are given the free will to associate to whatever political party they think right, and you know, and stuff like that. And I think that is a problem. And when recently the Minister of Information, who is a veteran journalist in this country, who have fought for freedom of the press in this country, now the Minister of Information, shut down the radio station of the opposition. You know, shut down the radio station of the opposition, the people who gave their own party the license to operate.
Sheka Tarawali. Mohamed D. Koroma. IB Kapo. A not-so-holy trinity, they are the president's pressmen, unleashing persecution on their peers. Sierra Leone's journalists could be in an Orwellian nightmare, in which some of their number, previously the victims of persecution themselves, have metamorphosed into persecutors of their own kind.
Discipline. Our lower animals do more work and eat less than on other farms. This will encourage you to make your lower animals work even harder and eat even less. To a greater animal farm. To peace and plenty under pig rule.